Hey everyone, welcome back to Catholicism Wow. So today we're going to do something a little different than I usually do with my rebuttal videos. Today we're going to respond to a video of Isaiah Saldivar, who is a Protestant YouTuber, reacting to the George Farmer, Allie Beth Stuckey debate on the Daily Wire. And, hosted by Candace Owens. And we're gonna not just respond to Isaiah's arguments or Isaiah's reactions. We're also going to, I'm also going to offer my own thoughts on this part of the debate, because it's not the entire debate. It's only a short clip about Mary and the intercession to the saints. And there are some things that I don't think George Farmer gets quite right. So I will be correcting those things as well. So let's get into it.
Okay, what Catholics and Protestants believe about Mother Mary. This was a debate between Allie Stuckey, which I'm just starting to learn about, and then I think his name is George Farmer. That's Candace Owens' husband. So they debated. He's a Catholic. Allie Stuckey is a Protestant. And they're going to talk about Mary. There's a lot of other clips from this podcast, but I want to react to this one. Maybe I'll react to more in the future from this. Let me know in the comments down below. But let's watch this together and see, what is the Catholic view on Mary? Because I think it's a huge point of contention. A lot of Christians are like, you guys pray to Mary, you ask for intercession, which is a valid argument and a valid concern. It's a concern I have for sure when it comes to the Catholic doctrine, among many others. But that's a whole nother video that I have. I'll probably put that down below. My Catholics versus Catholics compared to Christians. But let's watch this and react.
First of all, and I get so tired of having to say this, Catholics are Christians. We affirm all of the basic mere Christian doctrines that would count somebody as being a Christian. The word you're looking for, Isaiah, is Protestant. That's the word you're looking for. And he'll also later on, he'll refer to Protestants as Orthodox Christians. He'll say, if you're an Orthodox Christian, you're a Protestant. When he says that, he's not talking about the Eastern Orthodox Church. He is trying to make the claim that Protestants are the most Orthodox Christians. And that's a dubious claim, but we'll get into that. And as for your Catholics versus Christians video, I can't wait.
React.
I would say that the sola scriptura thing actually was one of the easier things for me to get over when studying the Catholic faith. And I thought it was a very good argument that it actually like showed me where in the Bible that you see this. And the answer is I couldn't find it. One of the things that was not so easy and is not, I don't even want to make it sound like it's past tense for me, Mary, Virgin Mary, praying on the rosary, trying to understand what the Catholic faith believes. Well, we're not praying to her, which is the veneration of Mother Mary. It's something that still makes me a little bit uncomfortable, I'm going to be honest.
So I don't know where Candace Owens stands between, I don't think she's Catholic, I don't know if she's Christian or not, I don't watch much of her content, but she's saying like, I have an issue with this. I don't understand this whole praying to the rosary. And a lot of Catholics in my comments and a lot of Catholics watch my content, they're going to say, we don't pray to Mary, but in catechism, you literally get taught to pray to Mary. It's in the doctrine. So you can say as a Catholic, you don't pray to Mary or you don't believe in it, but the Catholic doctrine for sure teaches not just asking Mary for intercession, but praying to Mary and even worshiping Mary, which again, I know Catholics say, we don't do that, but the doctrine does teach that.
I would challenge Isaiah to produce for me an official Catholic doctrine or Catholic teaching that says not only should we pray to the saints, but we should worship them. Yes, the Catholic Church does endorse praying through the saints, praying with the saints, praying to the saints, if that's how you want to call it. Whatever it is, the Catholic Church endorses the idea that the saints in heaven who are near God, who are alive in Christ, they are not dead. The only thing changed about them from their earthly life till their heavenly life is their location. They've gone from being on earth to being in heaven. Yes, the Catholic Church does teach that they can pray for us. They pray for us even when we do not ask them to. because they are with us. And they aren't just the canonized saints. It's not just St. John Paul II and St. Teresa of Calcutta and St. Thomas Aquinas and St. Augustine, St. Joan of Arc. It's not just those saints. It's your departed loved ones, your grandmother, your grandfather, your mother. Those who are our loved ones who prayed for us in this life, now pray for us in the life to come. Nowhere does it say anything about worship. But don't take my word for it. Let's see what the Catechism of the Catholic Church has to say. A Cloud of Witnesses, paragraph 2683 of the Catechism of the Catholic Church. The witnesses who have preceded us into the kingdom, especially those whom the Church recognizes as saints, share in the living tradition of prayer by the example of their lives, the transmission of their writings, and their prayer today. They contemplate God, praise Him, and constantly care for those whom they have left on earth. When they entered into the joy of their Master, they were put in charge of many things. Their intercession is their most exalted service to God's plan. We can and should ask them to intercede for us and for the world. Then we move on to paragraph 2684. In the communion of saints, many and varied spiritualities have been developed throughout the history of the churches. The personal charism of some witnesses to God's love for men has been handed on, like the spirit of Elijah to Elisha and John the Baptist, so that their followers may share in this spirit. A distinct spirituality can also arise at the point of convergence of liturgical and theological currents, bearing witness to the integration of the faith into a particular human environment and its history. The different schools of Christian spirituality share in the living tradition of prayer and are essential guides for the faithful. In their rich diversity, they are refractions of the one pure light of the Holy Spirit. The Spirit is truly the dwelling of the saints, and the saints are for the Spirit a place where He dwells as in His own home, since they offer themselves as a dwelling place for God and are called His temple. And now let's take a look at what Pope Francis said on the subject at a general audience in 2021. From the Holy See, Pope Francis, General Audience, Library of the Apostolic Palace, Wednesday, April 7th, 2021. Catechesis on Prayer, Praying in Communion with the Saints. Dear brothers and sisters, good morning. Today I would like to reflect on the connection between prayer and the communion of saints. In fact, when we pray, we never do so alone. Even if we do not think about it, we are immersed in a majestic river of invocations that precedes us and proceeds us after death. Contained in the prayers we find in the Bible that often resound in the liturgy are the traces of ancient stories, of prodigious liberations, of deportations and sad exiles, of emotional returns, of praise ringing out before the wonders of creation. And thus, these voices are passed on from generation to generation in a continual intertwining between personal experience and that of the people and the humanity to which we belong. No one can separate themselves from their own history, the history of their own people. We always carry this inheritance in our attitudes and also in prayer. In the prayers of praise, especially those that blossom from the hearts of the little ones and the humble, echo parts of the magnificent that Mary lifted up to God in front of her relative Elizabeth, or of the exclamation of the elderly Simeon, who, taking baby Jesus in his arms, said, "Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace, according to thy word," Luke 2:29. Prayers, those that are good, are expansive. They propagate themselves continuously. With or without being posted on social media, from hospital wards, from moments of festive gatherings to those in which we suffer silently, the suffering of each is the suffering of all. and one's happiness is transmitted to someone else's soul. Suffering and happiness are part of a single history. They are stories that create history in one's own life. This history is relived in one's own words, but the experience is the same. Prayer is always born again. Each time we join our hands, we open our hearts to God. We find ourselves in the company of anonymous saints and recognized saints who pray with us and who intercede for us as older brothers and sisters who have preceded us on this same human adventure. In the church, there is no grief that is born in solitude. There are no tears shed in oblivion, because everyone breathes and participates in one common grace. It is no coincidence that in the ancient church, people were buried in gardens surrounding a sacred building, as if to say that, in some way, the multitude who preceded us participate in every Eucharist. Our parents and grandparents are there. Our godfathers and godmothers are there. Our catechists and other teachers are there. That faith that we passed on, transmitted, that we received along with the faith, the way of praying and prayer was also transmitted. Saints are still here, not far away from us, and their representations in churches evoke that cloud of witnesses that always surrounds us, Hebrews 12:1. At the beginning, we heard the reading of the passage from the letter to the Hebrews. They are witnesses that we do not adore. Certainly, we do not adore these saints, but whom we venerate and who, in thousands of different ways, bring us to Jesus Christ, the only Lord and mediator between God and humanity. A saint who does not bring you to Jesus Christ is not a saint, not even a Christian. A saint makes you remember Jesus Christ because he or she journeyed along the path of life as a Christian. Saints remind us that holiness can blossom even in our lives, however weak and marked by sin. In the Gospels, we read that the first saint to be canonized was a thief, and he was canonized not by a pope, but by Jesus himself. Holiness is a journey of life, of a long, short, or instantaneous encounter with Jesus, but always as a witness. A saint is a witness, a man or woman who encountered Jesus and followed Jesus. It is never too late to convert to the Lord who is good and great in love. Psalm 103, verse 8. The Catechism explains that the saints contemplate God, praise Him, and constantly care for those whom they have left on earth. Their intercession is their most exalted service to God's plan. We can and should ask them to intercede for us and for the whole world, Catechism of the Catholic Church, 2683. There is a mysterious solidarity in Christ between those who have already passed to the other life and we pilgrims in this one. Our deceased loved ones continue to take care of us from heaven. They pray for us, and we pray for them, and we pray with them. We already experience this connection in prayer here in this earthly life, this connection of prayer between ourselves and the saints, that is, between us and those who have already reached the fullness of life. This bond of prayer, we pray for each other, we ask for and offer prayers. The first way to pray for someone is to speak to God about him or her. If we do this frequently, every day, our hearts are not closed, but open to our brothers and sisters. We pray for others in the first way to love them, and it moves us toward concretely drawing near. Even in the moments of conflict, a way of dissolving the disagreement, of softening it, is to pray for the person with whom I am in conflict. And something changes with prayer. The first thing that changes is my heart, my attitude. The Lord changes it to make an encounter possible, a new encounter to prevent the conflict from becoming a never-ending war. The first way to face a time of anguish is to ask our brothers and sisters, the saints above all, to pray for us. The name given to us at baptism is not a label or a decoration. It is usually the means of the Virgin or a saint who expects nothing other than to give us a hand in life. to give us a hand to obtain the grace we need from God. If the trials in our life have not reached breaking point, we are still capable of persevering. If despite everything we proceed trustingly, perhaps more than to our own merits, we owe all this to the intercession of many saints, and some who are in heaven, and others who are pilgrims like us on earth, who have protected and accompanied us, because we all know there are holy people here on this earth, saintly men and women who live in holiness. They do not know it, nor do we know it, but there are saints, everyday saints, hidden saints, or as I like to say, the saints next door. Those who share their lives with us, who work with us, and who live a life of holiness. Therefore, blessed be Jesus Christ, the only Savior of the world, together with this immense flowering of saintly men and women who populate the earth and who have made their life a hymn to God. For, as Saint Basil said, the Spirit is truly the dwelling of the saints, since they offer themselves as a dwelling place for God and are called His temple. Liber de Spiritu Sancto, 2662, page 32, paragraph 184a, and the Catechism of the Catholic Church, paragraph 2684. Nothing talks about worshiping saints or Mary. In fact, it talks about the opposite, especially in Pope Francis's sermon. Pope Francis acknowledges that Christ is the one mediator. Pope Francis acknowledges that Christ is the only Savior. The problem with Christ being the one mediator is that Protestants don't understand what that means. Jesus is the only person who has ever lived on this planet who can make it possible for us to have communion with God. Without the mediation of Jesus Christ, without his death and his sacrifice on the cross, his perfect sacrifice, we could not have fellowship with God. But that does not mean he is our only intercessor. And Allie Beth Stuckey will even make that claim. That claim that Christ is the only intercessor is nowhere found in Scripture. In fact, the opposite is found in Scripture, because we are told many times in Scripture, and we are shown examples many times in Scripture, of the body of Christ praying for one another. James even commands it. James says, confess your sins to one another and pray for each other. And this idea that the saints are dead so they're disqualified is nonsense. They are not dead. If you are going to die on that hill, all you're going to do is convince me that you don't believe in the promise of salvation. You don't believe in the promise of eternal life. If you have eternal life, you are by definition not dead.
Allie, do you feel the same about this?
Yeah, and now I would say, I'm not rehashing this little scripture thing because I know that we're moving past that, but it's not that Protestants don't believe that we can't deduce things. Like you said that, okay, it doesn't say in scripture, only by scripture alone, just as it doesn't say, well, here is the Holy Trinity. We do believe in deducing. We believe in theologians. We believe in creeds. We believe in councils in a similar way that the Catholic Church does. Kind of, but we would say nothing can bind the conscience except for the Word of God. Nothing has ultimate authority except yes. for the Word of God.
If nothing can bind the conscience except the written Word of God, the Bible, then how do we know what the written Word of God is? How do we know that our Bible has everything it's supposed to have in it? What if somebody were to come along and just throw out several books, let's say for the sake of argument, 7. How would we know that those books belong or don't belong? If the Bible is the only thing that can bind the conscience, what's to stop somebody from just throwing out those 7 books, a number that I just picked totally at random? The Bible does not contain a divine inspired table of contents. So if the Bible is the only thing that can bind your conscience, how do you know what the Bible is?
And that, and also we disagree with some of the deductions that the Catholic Church has made, one of them being Mary. And I'm sure that George will tell us what he believes the biblical support to be of Mary. But I would say,
good luck. Spoiler alert, there is none. That's the spoiler alert. There is no scriptures that say we should pray to anyone. In fact, the Bible literally says there is one mediator between us and God, the man Christ Jesus. So we don't have Mary as a mediator in the Bible, we're talking here, and in the Orthodox Christian faith. We don't have a mediator. We don't pray to the disciples. We don't pray to saints that have passed away. And you might, Catholics would say, well, they're not dead. We're not praying to dead people or communicating with the dead, which would be like necromancy, which is vehemently prohibited in scripture. But they would say they're still alive in heaven. They're not dead. But physically, they are dead. Physically, they are dead. And so, yeah, the Christian Bible does not teach to ask for anyone for intercession or to pray to saints that are physically dead.
Spoiler alert, it does though. It really does, I promise.
Dead. Yes, they say that they don't worship Mary. You say that you don't pray to Mary, but you're praying through Mary, mm-hmm. that she is kind of a mediator.
And the saints as well.
Yes, because they are, and you can correct me if I'm misrepresenting you, because I don't want to do that, but because of their proximity to God, basically they are kind of carrying our prayers to God, and Mary, being the mother of God, has a special place, a special authority to do that. And of course, I believe that that is not just wrong, but I actually believe that that's blasphemous, that she has no divine authority. Yes, she's blessed in the sense of what an honor and what a privilege that she was a servant of God, that she was able to carry Jesus. But Jesus alone is our mediator.
Yes.
He alone is our intercessor. He alone is who we pray to and through. And while Mary is in heaven, we don't believe that anyone is in heaven because of their proximity to God has any authority or ability whatsoever to carry our prayers to him.
Really good. I'm new to her content, so I've only seen a little bit of it. I have some friends that really like her stuff. I really like the way she communicates. I think she communicated that precisely, clearly, and so I think she does a great job at communicating her point, taking the Protestant position, which you're like, what's a Protestant? We're Protestant. If you're an Orthodox Christian, you'd be considered a Protestant versus, you know, she's talking to someone who's a Catholic. So I think she really is strong on this. She's saying it clear. She's saying it bold. She's not afraid to step over that line and maybe be offensive with what the Bible says. And so I really like this whole interview and all the clips from it. And again, maybe I'll react to more, but interesting.
The problem is what she said so succinctly and so clearly is just wrong. It's not what the Bible says. The only thing that she got right that the Bible says is that Christ is the one mediator, and the Catholic Church affirms this. The problem is you're confusing a mediator with an intercessor. If you truly believe that Christ is the only intercessor, then you can't ask your friends, your family, your loved ones, your pastor, your dog. You can't ask any of them to pray for you. You have to go through your Christian life all on your own with just you and your Bible and God. What a lonely, lonely, pitiful existence that would have to be. And no Protestant would ever affirm that, because Protestants ask people to pray for them all the time. The only difference is, for some reason, they deny that the saints have eternal life. God is not the God of the dead. He's the God of the living. Everything in Scripture testifies to a saved person after they have departed the mortal coil. They're alive in Christ. They're alive in heaven. They have eternal life. They are alive. They're not dead.
Interesting.
We just don't see that deduced in Scripture. That would be a big difference. And I would say, now this could go against Catholic doctrine, but there comes something very close to Mary worship, I would say, in subsets of Catholicism, which is interesting because you hear Catholics say a lot, oh, look at all these Protestant denominations. There are a lot of subsets of Catholicism, even if they're not called
good
different
point.
Denominations.
That's not a good point. That's an objectively, abysmally terrible point. there are what she's referring to as subsets of the Catholic Church are different churches that make up the single Catholic Church. There are 24 Catholic churches, only one of them being the Roman Catholic Church. There's the Byzantine Catholic Church, there's the Chalcedonian Catholic Church, but the difference between the rites in the Catholic Church and the denominations in Protestantism is that we do agree on the essentials, and we are all in communion with the Bishop of Rome, the leader of the church on earth, the Pope. We are united by the Pope. So we may have different liturgies, we may dress differently, we may have different culture, but we are all part of the one collective Catholic Church. You can't make that claim.
So, that's just an issue in general. But that would be my issue with praying through Mary, is that we don't see her as a mediator in Scripture.
And I agree with that position, so I'm very happy.
Candace says to her husband, oh, she says, I agree with that. Which it can be, it's really awkward for Candace being a mediator or, like, hosting this debate, because they're labeling this as, like, a debate. So probably a little bit awkward for Candace being a mediator between, I'm guessing, her friend and her husband. So let's keep watching.
So the claim that Allie Beth Stuckey made is that nowhere in the Bible do we see Mary acting as an intercessor. And to that, I say this. A reading from the Gospel according to John, chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. On the third day, there was a marriage at Cana in Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus was also invited to the marriage with his disciples. When the wine failed, the mother of Jesus said to him, they have no wine. And Jesus said to her, O woman, what have you to do with me? My hour has not yet come. His mother said to the servants, do whatever he tells you. Now 6 stone jars were standing there for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to them, fill the jars with water. And they filled them up to the brim. He said to them, now draw some out and take it to the steward of the feast. So they took it. When the steward of the feast tasted the water now become wine, he did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. The steward of the feast called the bridegroom and said to him, every man serves the good wine first, and when men have drunk freely, then the poor wine, but you have kept the good wine until now. This, the first of his signs, Jesus did at Cana in Galilee and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. After this, he went down to Capernaum with his mother and his brethren and his disciples, and there they stayed for a few days. The Gospel of the Lord. So we see from this gospel passage that when the wedding party had run out of wine, they went to Mary. They said to Mary, we've run out of wine. We don't know what to do. And then Mary went to Jesus and said, they don't have any wine. Jesus then at first tells her, woman, go away. It's not my time yet. This is none of my business. But then at the behest of his mother, he does the miracle. And she doesn't even plead with him to do the miracle. He tells her no, and she goes and starts telling the servants to prepare the jars anyway and to do whatever he tells them. And then Jesus does the miracle because his mother asked him to, because the wedding party went to her and she went to him. She's literally acting as an intercessor in that entire story.
Happy to hear your answer to that, because this has probably been my biggest hang up, to be honest with you.
This is like Quiz the Catholic. So there was a phrase which I want to come back to, which I think was very interesting, Adam, what you just said, which is the mother of God. Right. And I would start by asking, is that your position?
Mother of Jesus. And of course, I believe Jesus is the Word and the Word is God, John 1. And so I guess you could say, I guess I probably wouldn't typically say the phrase Mother of God. I typically would say Mother of Jesus.
That's a very...
Where is he going with this?
Interesting answer, I would say, because and I'm going to get pretty theological here, kind of very quickly. So the Council of Ephesus in 431 defined Mary as the Mother of God. And the reason that the Council of Ephesus, as one of the authoritative church councils, defined Mary as the Mother of God was because it was facing the Nestorian crisis.
Now, I don't think it's wrong to say Mary was the Mother of God because Jesus is God. For sure, 100% Jesus is God. I've done teaching after teaching about that in my verse by verse, definitively proving the Bible does teach Jesus is God. It's just kind of a weird way to say it that Mary's the Mother of God. We would say Mary's the mother of Jesus, as Ellie said. So, yeah, I don't know. I don't know where he's getting at, but, yeah, for sure.
Time,
I mean,
I
Jesus
earlier.
Is God.
The Nestorian crisis said, led by Bishop Nestorius, said that Christ was two persons, and it was two natures, right, within Christ. It could not, and this was the whole, and I'm really abbreviating here, and there's a lot more literature written on this by much better people than me. But it is worth looking into this because basically what this was saying is that Christ was two natures, right? He was his human nature and he was his divine nature.
He's
right?
kind of going in circles, but I think he's trying to tell us why they prayed
and
to Mary or
what
asked Mary for intercession.
The church eventually came to define was that Christ could not be two natures. He had to be one nature, right? Hypostatically unified, right? Which is what the creeds,
yeah, like that.
Exactly, because you cannot divide the nature of God,
right?
Right. And in doing so, the church anathematized Nestorius and excluded him from communion with Holy Mother Church. And the reason being was because, as I said, you're dividing the nature of God. And then there's a whole conversation about persons and how do you unify a person, et cetera, et cetera. These were the Christological debates that the church
faced.
Come
on, just tell us.
Centuries.
Why do you guys pray to Mary or through Mary or ask Mary for
intercession? The reason the Council of Ephesus came up with
This is where George Farmer is, I think, a little bit confused. Because Christ does have two natures. The church affirmed that Christ has two natures at the Council of Ephesus. But those natures cannot be divided. Mary is not the mother simply of a human nature. She is the mother of the person Jesus Christ. And that person is 100% God and 100% man. Two natures. It isn't that the two natures was the heresy. It's that you could separate those natures. That was the heresy. And George Farmer seems to be on the right track, but he's not articulating it properly. So, and I think it's important for us as Catholics to point out when somebody is not articulating something in the best way. I'm not telling you you're wrong. I'm not telling you I don't believe what you're trying to say. I don't affirm what you're trying to say. But what I am saying is that you're not saying it in the best way that you could. And a lot of times if we say things in a less than perfect way, we can sow confusion. And then we end up with this nonsense. So George Farmer is not exactly correct. I get where he's going. I get what he's saying. But he's not saying it right. And also, I share in Isaiah's frustration as to why he just won't answer the question. Because this should be a slam dunk, honestly. There is scripture that shows praying to the saints. That shows the saints taking our prayers to the Lamb, to Jesus Christ. And I don't know why he doesn't just pull that out.
Because Mother of God, and define this, was because without saying that Mary was the Mother of God, you left yourself open to the backdoor argument that effectively again, she was the mother of Jesus.
Right.
She was not the mother of God. She was the mother of one of the persons of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
So in that argument, right, Mary is the mother of God, right? She must have given birth to God, right? And that is the reason that in the Catholic, that is one of the reasons.
She's the second person of the Trinity, yes. Not
correct.
God the Father,
correct.
But
correct.
God the God-man, yes.
Correct, but in the same way.
Still fully God.
Still
so I
fully
see
God.
Point.
Exactly. In the same way that you can't say that, like, humans, you know, humans are mad.
This is way going around the question, because the question was, in the Bible, where do we see this?
You shouldn't even try to do a metaphor for the Trinity, George.
Well, no. I'm saying, like...
complicated.
Of course it is. Of course it is. But you want to make sure that you're not trying to break out... Again, it comes back to the natures conversation, right? You don't want to split the natures of Christ, because that becomes the real issue. So, Mary was the mother of God in confirming Christ's divinity, right? And again, this is like the Daily Wire, and this is, we don't want to get, you know, into the 5th century Christological debates, but that was the reason that she was defined in that way. As a result, the church, for that reason, plus many others, would have argued that what is traditionally ascribed to God, which is called latria, right, is adoration. Latria is the full adoration of God. It can only be given to God. It is what is celebrated in the Mass. It is what is celebrated in adoration of the Blessed Sacrament. Dulia, which is a second stage, which is what will be described as veneration, can be ascribed to Mary. Now, what is actually described to Mary is hyperdulia, because she contains this unique position of being the mother of God. The saints are granted dulia, which is veneration. Hmm. And the conversation around saints, for example, I would say is similar to, like, you know, and I think this is the most applicable metaphor would be like...
George, we're in the Bible.
Right.
We're in the Bible. Christian brothers, does it say we're supposed to pray to saints?
Please
pray for me.
Please pray for me about...
So I think George Farmer was going on that entire Theotokos rant to sort of explain how the veneration that we give to Mary is one owed to her, and two, completely different than the worship that we give to God. So it was in response to the accusations of Mary worship that Allie Beth Stuckey did make. However, that wasn't the question that was being posed to him at that moment. The question that was being posed to him at that moment was, where in Scripture does it say to pray to the saints, or that the saints take our prayers to Christ? And to that end, the answer to that question is in Revelation 5:8. In Revelation 5:8, John sees... the 24 elders, and they all have bowls of incense, and the incense, and they're giving these bowls of incense to the Lamb, which is a metaphor for Jesus in this prophetic, you know, dream and vision, whatever. And the bowls of incense are the prayers of the saints being the faithful here on earth. So in this metaphor, the saints, or the elders, are the saints in heaven, and the saints, small s, are the faithful on earth. The elders, the saints in heaven, are delivering our prayers to the Lamb. How can they do that if we do not give them our prayers? That is the scriptural answer to the question. And not only that, but we also see... Isaiah levels the accusation of necromancy, and praying to saints is not necromancy. Praying through saints, praying with saints, however you want to say it, is not necromancy. Necromancy is trying to get information from the dead. We are trying to give information to the saints. We want to give them our intercession so that they can bring them to Christ, like the Bible says that we ought to. But not only that, but as I said before, the saints are not dead. And we know this from Scripture, from the transfiguration of Jesus. At the transfiguration, Jesus sees Elijah and Moses in the clouds, alive and well, and he speaks to them. So you have a man on earth, fully God as he may have been, speaking to very alive saints in heaven. So there is scriptural basis for this. And it, like I said, it's a slam dunk, and I don't know why George Farmer is avoiding the question. But let's get back to it.
This issue, please pray for me about this topic. I'm struggling with this. I'm struggling with sin, etc., etc. In the same way that we ask other Christians, brothers and sisters, to pray for us, we are asking the saints. The Catholic worldview would say that doesn't stop at dead, at death. It continues afterwards, right? In the same way that, for example, like purgatory, which is a state of purification of the soul prior to entry.
Which is not a Christian doctrine or a Christian belief.
Protestants don't believe.
Protestants don't believe in.
Purgatory absolutely is a Christian doctrine, and it was for 1500 years until Martin Luther decided that he had a problem with it. And we can find this in scripture in 1 Peter 1:7 and in 1 Corinthians 3:13, where both passages talk about our works in Corinthians and our faith in Peter being tested as through fire. And in 1 Corinthians 3, it even says that that we will be saved, but only as through fire, even if our works are burned up. That's purgatory, folks.
That would be the same logic. We would say souls afterlife continue to make intercession, like souls on this earth continue to ask for intercession.
And where do you get the basis, though, that souls continue to make intercession once they're in heaven?
Where in the Bible, George? Where in the Bible does it say this? Again, spoiler alert, it doesn't. That's the problem. The Bible doesn't teach this idea of when you go to heaven, you're praying, or you're in hell, you're praying for people, which, yeah,
there
just
are several areas in the New Testament where people are saying, I mean, I can definitely dig out some quotes for you if you like. From
just give us one.
Revelation 5:8, that's the one. And it's so frustrating that he doesn't just say it. Because like I said, that is such a slam dunk. They only want one. There are several we can give them. Revelation 5:8.
Which talk about that. Again, coming back to our first point, because it is not singularly defined in scripture does not mean that the church cannot uphold it as a doctrine, right? So again, this comes back to the sola scriptura argument.
Which is our whole disagreement.
Which is part of the whole.
Yeah, so not everything's in scripture. Scripture's not exhaustive. There's things that are outside of scripture that are still okay. They go in line. They're harmonious with the word of God. But when something goes against scripture, which praying to saints or Mary or asking them for intercession would go against scripture, not only is necromancy, which is talking to the dead, prohibited, and they are physically dead, even though they could be in heaven, but also we have only one mediator, so we don't use them as mediators to God or the Father. So this is anti-biblical. It's not just extra biblical, it's anti-biblical.
Disagreement.
Praying to saints is only anti-biblical if you don't understand the Bible. And it's not Isaiah's fault that he doesn't understand the Bible, because he's been formed by pastors and preachers and a worldview that discounts these things. It just ignores these scriptures. It just ignores the difference between a mediator and an intercessor. It ignores the logic that if we have eternal life, we are by definition not dead. It ignores the logic that if you can ask your friend on earth to pray for you, why can't you ask your friend in heaven to pray for you? And not only that, but James chapter 5 tells us that that the prayers of the righteous hold much power. Who is more righteous than those in heaven? Who is more righteous than those that have finished the race, that have stayed the course, that have made it? Yes, we have one mediator, but that does not mean intercessor. Intercessor and mediator are not the same thing. And the one mediator between God and man simply means that Jesus is the only person who has ever lived that makes it possible for us to have communion and fellowship with God the Father.
So the church itself has confirmed that, but there are plenty of places, and I can dig out some quotes from.
Show us one. If there's plenty, show us one.
Where there are plenty of places where intercession is asked for, right, in the afterlife.
Where?
Yeah, I guess I would need to see this.
Well, I would say one of them, for example, is the parable of the rich man and Lazarus.
In Abraham's bosom.
Exactly.
No, right. This is so not good. Case, don't go there.
And he doesn't.
He doesn't, but he is making intercession. The rich man is asking for hell that Abraham sends to his brothers and sisters, testimony of his pain in hell, right? And Abraham says no because he has the prophets and Moses. That doesn't mean that the option, that does not mean that he could not have done it, right? It just means that he decided not to in that circumstance, right?
So, that's a poor illustration. If you're using that to justify biblically praying to saints or asking them for intercession, terrible, terrible, terrible spot to use, where a man's literally in hell saying, send somebody to my brothers to warn them, and then saying that's making intercession. So that would also say, if a Catholic's using that argument, that would say, so you're praying in hell. If you're in hell, you're praying for people. So it's just a very poor argument. You just can't get there from here.
So again,
I agree. The rich man and Lazarus is a terrible example. Revelation 5:8. Pull out Revelation 5:8. That's the slam dunk. The problem with the rich man and Lazarus is that this does not show people on earth asking for the intercession of the saints in heaven. This shows a person that's been damned asking God to warn his brothers on earth so that the fate that happened to him doesn't happen to them. And God says no. So, yeah, I mean, this is not going to convince Protestants. And our goal should be to convince them, not just to argue with them, not just to one-up them, not just to own them, not just to make them look silly. It should be to convince them. It should be to let them know they are missing out on biblical truths.
So again, the fact that petitions are being made in the afterlife is referenced in a parable.
Even from hell? Is that a belief?
No, I wouldn't. I'm using that.
Well, that's why I'm not sure if that's a good example, because I don't think Catholic doctrine says you can pray to people from hell and they can intercede.
No, I'm not saying that it does, but I'm saying that there is examples in the
checkmate. I'm sorry, bro. You lost
Bible
this.
Where
you just lost. I'm sorry.
Scripture tests the fact that people in the afterlife are making petitions. Right now, whether or not that is from hell is not a Catholic position.
Yeah,
no.
I would. Yeah, I guess I would just need to see the biblical support for that, or where, because you talked about how the
there are testimony in again, you're not going to use these because the Apocrypha is not upheld, but in Tobit, for example, where life after death is attested to, in Sirach as well. These
which are not canon, canonized, are not scripture. They're not biblical.
And again, that brings us back to the point that I made earlier in the video. If the Bible is your only infallible authority, how do you know it's right? Because there is no divine inspired table of contents. There is nothing in the Bible that affirms or confirms what should be in the Bible. So how do you know that the Deuterocanonicals are not biblical, that they're not a part of sacred scripture? How do you know that? If the Bible is your only source of authority, the only thing that can bind the conscience, then how do you know that those books don't belong? Because the Bible is not the only thing that can bind the conscience. The church can also bind the conscience, and that's how we know what belongs in the Bible, because the church told us. The church gave us the Bible, and those seven books were in the Bible until 1825. For 1825 years, those seven books were in the Bible. Even after the Protestant Reformation, even after they were demoted and, you know, decanonized, which, by the way, the Protestant Reformers had no authority to do. But even when they did that, they still left them in. And then it wasn't until publishers tried saving money in the 1800s that they finally took them out, so that they could decrease the page count and still charge the same amount of money for a Bible.
There are references in Hebrews to the fact that continuous offerings are being made in heaven on part of the priesthood, which is also
Jesus, the high priest, is forever making intercession
in communion with how we as Catholics identify the Mass, which is a continual offering, right? So there are several circumstances where the example of offerings in heaven being made, right, are attested to in Scripture, right?
And so Mary is a super mediator because she is the Mother of God. She has super authority in heaven to carry our prayers.
She is, yes, she is the, as in her unique position.
I just don't understand. Why would you go to Mary if you can go directly to Jesus? Well, Mary is going to bring our prayers to Jesus and he'll answer his mother, but just go straight to him. The veil's been torn. We've been given the power and the authority to boldly approach the throne of grace. Like it makes absolutely no sense why go to Mary. You can literally skip Mary and go directly to Jesus. Our relationship is not with Mary. The gospel's about Jesus bringing us now into relationship with the Father, giving us peace with God, and now we have a relationship with Jesus and the Father. Like, that's the gospel. So why go to Mary? I don't understand.
Mother of God.
Why go to your pastor? Why go to your friends? Why go to your family? Why go to anyone? Why ask anyone to ever pray for you? Yes, we have a relationship with Jesus and with God. Yes, we do. The veil is broken. Yes, Jesus did make it possible for us to have fellowship with Christ or with the Father through Christ. However, we are also a community of believers. We are also to have fellowship with one another. We should be helping each other. We should be holding each other accountable. And yes, we should be praying for each other. And this does include our brothers and sisters who have made it into the fullness of the beatific vision
of God. She is in a position, and of course, like Catholics would also argue that, for example, this
it's exhaustive. Why go to Mary?
Where a woman is brought forth and she gives birth, right, to the one who will save the world. There are plenty of examples of
that's
course,
not what it's saying, brother. I'm sorry,
mentioned many times in the same way that Peter is mentioned more than all the other apostles put together in the gospels. Mary is mentioned several times as Jesus's mother. She has a unique place at the foot of the cross. Her unique positioning is clear within scripture, and again, this comes back to what
no,
I said
it's
about
not
the mother of God and this being dogmatically defined in a church council, which, by the way, the Protestant church accepts the Council of Ephesus. It's not rejected. So in all of these circumstances, Mary's unique position is upheld as hyperdulia.
Yeah, so he ran around the topic. He didn't answer any of the questions. He didn't use the Bible for sure. The only example he gave was the rich man and Lazarus, which was an absolutely terrible example because it's literally a man in hell saying, please send someone to warn my brothers. It's not about intercession or prayer. So just the whole praying to Mary, if you're Catholic, let me know in the comments. If you're still watching this by the end, type amen in the comments so I know that you watched the whole video. But no, this is just anti-biblical. We don't pray to saints. We don't pray to Mary. We don't ask for intercession. If we're going to be biblical, we go straight to Jesus. It just makes sense. It's the clear, precise thing to do. It's the biblical thing to do. If you start trying to pray to saints and Mary, you're opening yourself up to familiar spirits. We know that witches use saints to pray to get intercession. It's all in the New Age and the occult uses praying to saints. No, no, no. Don't open yourself up. Don't do it. Don't pray to Mary. Don't worship Mary. You can go directly to Jesus and you have authority and power to do that. Pray about becoming a partner with our ministry down below. You can.
Amen. Yes, I did get to the end of your video and I will do you one better, or I have done you one better. Instead of just telling you in the comments, I made this video. Now, I don't know if Isaiah is going to see this video. I will see if I can try and tag him in social media. And hopefully, I honestly hope and I pray that with this video, if Isaiah does watch it, that it might have cleared up some confusion that he did have, because George Farmer did dance around the questions. George Farmer wasn't very concise. George Farmer wasn't clear. And so I hope that I've been able to be more clear. If you like this video, please subscribe and share. I've got 112 subscribers now. I lost one somewhere. So whoever you are, whatever I did to piss you off, I sincerely apologize. But you know, we're taking it and we're coming and going. If you are going to unsubscribe, at least let me know why. Comment in whatever video it was that made you feel like this channel wasn't for you. And if it's something that I can change or fix, I'll do that. But anyway, so yeah, do all the YouTube things and we'll see you next time.